Thank you for being here. First question, a few weeks ago you announced that you're challenging the decision to remove the management to the Bucharest Airports company. Why that?
Well, first of all, there is this corporate governance legislation about that should be implemented in all state-controlled companies, and it was implemented before in Bucharest Airports, and this this legislation requires a proper selection process before board is changed or new members of the board are implemented. And it clearly didn't happen more. We didn't see any reason for the current board and the management to be replaced, especially because, you know, very good performance that the company started registering last year. I think net profits were more than 40% up, and also looking at the work that has been done by the management and the board, there were prospects to significantly improve performance this year. We simply couldn't understand this urgency in making these changes, as well as quality of replacements compared to the previous board.
What happened with this legal challenge? Any results yet?
Well, we still in court. We ask for suspension of these decisions, and in this case, court didn't decide in our favor. But right now, we're challenging the entire process of making these changes. And from our perspective, it looked more like a coup than really a change of the board in a company, in any company.
Do you have any explanation for this coup?
We couldn't understand it, as I said, especially that we didn't see any wrongdoing from the side of the previous board. And no one has showed us any evidence that would lead us to believe that there was really something bad happening in the company. It exactly was, from our perspective, the opposite. They've terminated and changed a number of contracts that were clearly not beneficial for the Bucharest Airport.
We've seen this kind of behavior from the Romanian government in the last 2 months with some other state-owned companies where the management, the corporate management was removed. How do you assess this behavior of the government?
Well, I mean, it happened also in the case of the previous government, and overall in this corporate governance improvements, what we've seen, it's usually, you know, two steps forward, one step back. I mean, this was definitely a step back, but we hope and we're working on this to really change the situation very quickly, and for the Bucharest Airports to have a proper board and management team that can lead the company to become what it should be, and it's one of the leaders in the Romanian market, but also on the regional basis.
Is it possible that one explanation for this kind of acting is the fact that we are in a election year?
Well, I mean, I've been here for 4 years, so every year is an election year. And we've been through 5 different governments already. So there is always excuse that, oh, okay, it's after elections or before elections. But I think what should be done is to really disconnect the performance and the management and the boards of the state-controlled companies from politics. And that was the idea behind this corporate governance legislation. It has partially worked, and there are positive examples. But as I said, you know, depending on ministries or short-term interests of different stakeholders, of course, you know, there can be a distortion to this. From our perspective, if we look at the performance of all the state-controlled companies in our portfolio, we see really significant improvements in profitability year on year, and this higher profitability means that this company has become more valuable for the state, but also generate more dividends for the state budget.
Did you have a meeting with the Troika and the International Monetary Fund and the World Bank and the European Commission last month?
Yes, we had and we have very much more frequent meetings than that with them. I think the our cooperation with them has been going on very well, and I think we together we kind of complement our efforts because on one hand they come with different policies that the government should implement, but then we can let them know what's the real implementation of these policies.
I'm asking you mm-hmm. about this meeting because. Yeah. Besides you mm-hmm. and part of the civil society and the part of the press, this Troika is one of the gendarmes mm-hmm. Of these corporate governments.
Yeah.
Did they understand what is going on here?
Very well. I mean, they were. You know, we made them aware of all these positive and negative developments already in the past, and here we reviewed all the changes, recent developments in all the portfolio companies, and well, you should ask them, but in meetings with us, they were very disturbed, especially what happened in Bucharest airports.
In Bucharest airports?
Yeah.
We've seen them leaving without a conclusion of the visit. Do you think what happened in some state-owned company, not only Bucharest airports, is one of the reasons for this departure?
Well, definitely. Usually they come, they leave the country after these missions with some conclusions and comments on where they see this IMF program progressing. This time this corporate governance was definitely one of the reasons why they decided to postpone the review. Of this recent agreement, and we think that they're going to give government some more time to correct what has been done against the principles of this legislation.
Speaking about the state-owned companies, what's your position towards the government's intention to give basically for free some shares at Constanța Airport to the local authorities?
Well, first of all, in terms of Constanța Port, from our perspective, the most important, project for the company is the listing on the stock exchange. From our perspective, it's really secondary what the government is going to do with its own shares, whether they will transfer it to local authority for free or in exchange for something. It's purely the government decision, and from our perspective, we don't want to interfere with us. For us, the most important is to take a decision to list the company, and we are very strong supporters, and we're happy to work with the government and with the local authority on this project.
But if the government decides not to sell the shares on the stock exchange, but to give them to the local authority, are you going to sell your shares?
Well, if the company is unlisted, then it's very difficult for us to do anything with our stake. That's why, and it's also very difficult to think about the fair valuation for the shares in the company. But I think that from the perspective of transparency of the company, the operations, and the revenues that the company generate from this operators in the port, it's very important to really bring more transparency and more public knowledge about what's been happening in the company, and also what are the fees that the port charges the operators, because here we see a big upside for the port.
In April you said that at the energetic complex Oltenia mm-hmm. You met the least efficient management. Why so?
Well, I don't know why, I'm just stating the fact. No, I have to say that from this larger companies in our portfolio, this is the company where we haven't been able to really bring a change like it was in case in other companies. And I understand that it's coming from the past, also because of the miners and the big history of their protests here in Romania, but also the fact that there is still a lot of political influence and interest around this company. But truth is, from our perspective, that if none of the cost-cutting restructuring plans are introduced as it was agreed with us already 2 years ago, then the company is closer to going insolvent than coming to the stock exchange. And if you look at the value of this company in our portfolio, we had to reduce it by over 70% in 15 months. Mm-hmm. And that tells the story.
I see. Speaking about staying in this field of the state-owned companies, how do you see these very numerous feasibility studies that where they are putting a lot of money, millions and millions of euros? How do you see them? Because we tend sometimes to look at them as ways to simply steal the money.
Well, I wouldn't like to use this word that you just used, but definitely it's very surprising for us that special companies are being established just to do a feasibility study. We've offered to the government that we can be an agent to facilitate the studies for 10 or 20% of the cost that they had in mind by establishing this special companies for Tarnica or the underwater cable to Turkey. And we went also against the state control companies contributing money to these projects, and these cases are still in courts. So, you know, from our perspective, it's clearly not the way to go ahead with such projects, and estimates on the cost of this feasibility study are just crazy.
Can I guess the answer, the government answers to your proposal?
Well, you can.
For this year or for the next year, do you plan selling some stocks to the state-owned companies?
Well, in the state-owned companies. Well, I cannot comment on the listed companies because when we announce something, it has to be announced publicly to the market. We recently did this placement of part of our holding in Romgaz, and we may decide to do similar or other transactions in the future. But I guess the main objective of the fund and the strategy it stays the same. This is to create value to our shareholders, and one way of doing this is to increase the liquidity of our portfolio, and cash, of course, is the most liquid part that then we can use for the buybacks or distributions to shareholders.
Which brings me to the next question: which is your strategy for the next years? Rather to consolidate the performance in the companies where you are already a shareholder, or to search for new investments?
Well, we're not in a position right now to make new investments for the fund, and the main reason for this is is the gap between the net asset value of the fund and the valuation of the stock exchange and the share price. Right now, this discount is more than 30%. And it's impossible for us to justify any new investments. So until we really cut the discount at the same, hopefully also at the same time increasing the net asset value per share, we're not going to make any new investments. So all the cash that we'll be generating will be used either for the buybacks or distributions to shareholders. And one important, part of the strategy is also the listing in London. We think should bring new investors into the fund, and as a result, increase demand and increase the share price and cut the discount, and hopefully after that we will be able to justify new investments. But that's like the key tool that we would like to explore this year to significantly reduce this discount.
speaking about new money, about capital, did you see or do you see the capital coming to Romania from the region, from Russia or from Ukraine? Because there are a lot of talks mm-hmm. about the capital that is fleeing these countries mm-hmm. And sometimes stopping to Romania.
It's true. We do see it. I mean, we regular marketing fund the fund in Europe, US. So each time we either go on the roadshows or attend conferences, we do see a number of new investors who then become shareholders. And Romania is right now a part of the frontier markets. Yeah. And right now, this asset class, frontier markets, they do see large inflows globally of new money, and Romania being an important part of the index and growing part of the index is clear beneficiary of this. So the performance of the market has been relatively strong compared to other markets for more than a year now, and we think there is more coming. One also way to look at this is this our investor days. We organize these big conferences for our shareholders and investors every 6 months. The next one is at the end of this week, and we're having a record attendance in terms of number of participants, both local and foreign investors. And also the amount of money they manage. Right now it's over 900 billion euros under management, that the people that will be attending this conference, and more than 200 investors. So that's a record attendance. It also shows that this interest in Romania is growing.
Is this good money or money that is going to flee from Romania?
Oh, well, money is always good. I think you know, it's the most important part is to really attract someone and bring attention of investors to Romania, because there are many countries in the world that try to do the same, and Romania has to compete with them. So it doesn't matter what kind of money it is, as long as it's real money. It's very good. And of course, different investors have different strategies. Some of them are more short term, some of them are long term. I don't think that one can say that this money is good, this money is bad. No, all the money is good.
The economic fields that you feel that are most attractive for investors, both local and foreign, besides energy, of course, and agriculture that everybody is talking about.
We are mainly investors in listed companies, yeah. as Franklin Templeton. Other than Fondul, other Franklin Templeton funds, we have more than 200 million euros invested in the listed companies here. And then the choices are limited. That's why I think it's very important for the government, but also for private entrepreneurs, to really bring more companies to the market and give investors a chance to have exposure also to other sectors than banks and energy. These are the only major sectors that are listed now. There are a lot of opportunities, definitely in agriculture, although it's more on the side of private equity because mm-hmm. of limited size of these enterprises. But also in terms of services, IT, I think there are huge opportunities here.
I think there are lots of companies that are reluctant to go on the market because of many factors, but one of them is the lack of optimism. Because even if we see good macroeconomic figures for Romania, mm-hmm. Even if we are talking about investors coming here, mm-hmm. The results in the real economy are yet to be seen. How do you explain this delay between the good performance, the good macroeconomic performance, and the things that the people or the entrepreneurs are seeing in the markets?
Yeah, I think if you look at the the businesses, most of the owners of these businesses or managers, they should see improvements already, and one part of the economy that was a bit lagging was the local consumption. So, mm-hmm. and that's finally started growing. And why so late? That's what exactly what you said. Because of this lack of optimism or people being very negative or what's going to happen, partially also influenced by political developments. But if we look at the real numbers, real economy, I mean, we see a very good momentum for the economy to grow in all parts of the economy, really, including the domestic consumption, the retail sales. We were already seeing the growing numbers in terms of like quarterly or monthly basis. And very soon it will be also felt in the banking and financial sector. And then it doesn't take too much time from people being very negative to being very optimistic about their future and taking new mortgage loans, buying apartments, and spending more money. So it's all ahead of us. It's all looking good. I think the key now is for the key decision makers not to spoil it.
Speaking about the decisions, we've seen last week the parliament electing new boards for the National Bank and the ASF, and we saw there some people without relevant background. Are you worried about them getting there? Do you see bad effects or bad effects on short or medium term?
No, I think in terms of the central bank, I mean, Mr. Izarescu has been the head of the National Bank for many years now, and he has proven that he can deliver proper policies for a long time, regardless of less or more political appointments or non-executive positions. I mean, the most difficult challenge is ahead of the ASFE because it's a relatively young institution. Also after recent scandals, especially in the insurance sector. So there is more work to be done to really bring it up to international standards in terms of market supervision. But we're happy to also work with them as a large institution in the capital markets and support their efforts to really rebuild the respect of the investors.
And my last question is about the relationship between Romania and the International Monetary Fund and the European Commission, the World Bank. The Prime Minister announced that he doesn't want another
standby agreement.
Agreement next year. Do you think it's a good solution for Romania or not?
Let's put it this way. From the financial perspective, if financial markets stay relatively stable, I don't think that Romania needs it. But for the internal reforms. Mm-hmm. Of the country and the budgets and state-owned enterprise, it's good to have someone overseeing and pushing for changes. So from this perspective, it would be negative. But then hopefully that the politicians and the government at the time will have enough power and willingness to continue those reforms that have been started, because we think a lot of these reforms are very good for the country, and hopefully there will be people that also acknowledge it and will continue with this.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.